I'm the Badger, and welcome to my show, The Badger Show, and welcome to another Spooky Saturdays. Today, guys, we are going to be looking at Hammer Horror, and we're going to be doing a quick review on Woman in Black 2, The Angel of Death. So let's take a quick look at Hammer. Hammer Horror dominated the horror industry between the times of the 1950s to the 1970s, and they spawned such greats as Dracula, Frankenstein, and many other horror franchises, with famous actors such as Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing. You know, there was so much talent there. It was really well done, I thought. And it was one of these things where every film was based on a shoestring, and there was so much talent there. And the effects, yes, were very dated even for the time, but there was a certain magic in the films that made everyone come back over and over again. And the Dracula sequels were great, and I really enjoyed the battle between Van Helsing and Dracula. And of course there was many other films such as The Devil Rides Out, To a Devil or Daughter, loads and loads of really good horror films that were spawned from the studio. In the late 70s, the brand unfortunately died out, which was a real shame for a big horror fan like myself. But it soon came back in the 2007 with the films Let Me In, The Resident, and of course Woman in Black. And now, that leads us on to what we're going to be talking about today, which is Woman in Black 2. In Woman in Black 2, you have the teacher, and of course Edward, which is a newly orphaned World War orphan. Now, this is very upsetting as it is, but Woman in Black films are quite bleak. There's not much happiness there. So Edward is sent to Ilmarsh House with the rest of the evacuees, and the Woman in Black is not happy. Now, she sees it that the class have actually invaded her space, and she soon latches on to each of the children, especially Edward, who's lonely and upset with the fact that his mother and father have just died in the World War. Now, what you have to remember is that this is fast-forwarding from the first film to quite many years, because the original one was set in Victorian times, early Victorian times, and this is now either the First or the Second World War. So the house has dilapidated even more. There's been sort of, the spirits have got eviler, I suppose. Similar to House on a Haunted Hill, it's been there longer, so the demon has brewed. The Woman in Black is still not happy after what happened to the events of the first film. So there's a lot of evil brewing in there. And there's perhaps, because the house is dilapidated more, she can actually weave her way around the house more. And that actually is quite an interesting plot point once you see the film. There's gaps and nooks and crannies in the house that she can now get through that she couldn't before, which is an interesting plot point. Now, the film revolves solely around Edward and one of the teachers. Now, this is a really good point, and you'll have to watch it to understand. Now, there's a secret that happens to the teacher. I'm not going to reveal spoilers, because you may have seen it, but the teacher has got an impact on Edward, and Edward has a very strange impact on the teacher. So she's got very good reason to keep him alive and keep him safe. Now, the Woman in Black obviously wants Edward for herself, so we have to see what will happen. It's a really interesting storyline, and I think it, in fact, is a slightly better storyline than the first one, because it has multiple layers. So look out for that. Now, effects are really good. I must say that I didn't find the Woman in Black as menacing in this one as I did the first one. I think perhaps you see too much of her in the end. There's a big build-up, but you do see a lot of her as the film goes on. But they do use her in different ways. It's not just in the first one, like jump scares. They actually use her in different ways, similar to like a Japanese sort of spirit, evil spirit in a way, where she can crawl around, such like Ringu and The Grudge. She's got that sort of look to her now, in a way, with the hands and the crawling. Similar in Japanese folklore and things like that. So that's an interesting point. They use her in a different way. But there's a lot of good points there. They still use the lookout into the beach and the graveyard, which is a great imagery. Trust me, you have to watch it. Very haunting. You watch this film late at night, you will be scared. There's certain parallels with the 70s version of the first Woman in Black, with the beach scenes. And I love the fact that they're doing lots of stuff in the World War, and there's lots of different explosions. You actually see the Woman in Black's full potential, and she you see some more of her evil powers that she didn't perhaps have in the first one. So that was an interesting plot point that the writer of the book has added in, that she's got a bit more powerful. And I think maybe that's got to do with the fact that it's been a longer time period and she's actually got more and more powerful and more eviler as it goes along. Now, I'm not going to spoil the film too much because I'm not really into spoilers, but I must admit, there's a nice slow beginning, which I love in horror films, a really good build-up. The middle, very interesting, lots of scary things happen to the children, and of course the end is nail-biting, just like the first film. If you haven't seen that, I'm trying not to spoil that either. So there's lots of stuff going on. So I'd say the first half is nail-biting, the middle is similar to the first one, where bad things happen, there's lots of spooks, they set up for the end, and there's some really fantastic imagery at the end, trust me. And it does remind me of a lot of Japanese cinema. Very scary, actually. There's one particular scene where the woman in black is underwater, but I'm not going to reveal it, and it almost looks like she has tentacles with her hair, and that reminds me a lot of Japanese culture. So please check The Woman in Black 2 out. I think it has had a bad rap in the reviews and things like that. I personally think it did survive without Daniel Radcliffe and the cast of the first film. I was hoping that a few of the first film's actors and actresses would make appearances somehow, maybe as ghosts or flashbacks, but they didn't need to, I guess. But I recommend this film wholeheartedly, and I say 5 out of 5 scare factor. The boss was really scared, and she almost cuddled me and was very scared, jumping and saying, "I can't handle this, I can't handle this, turn it off." And we did have to watch the film in 2 halves, because you couldn't handle watching the whole hour and a half all the way through. So I would say, check this out for a popcorn night in, and if you want a good scare factor with the missus or a partner or whoever, it's a great film to watch and be scared together with. So I hope you enjoy that, guys, and I hope you enjoyed my spoiler-free review. So check out The Woman in Black 2 and let me know what you think. It's now on Amazon Prime, free for a short period. Bye for now, guys, and I hope you enjoyed the show.